And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. Blind, I am the RPG chick. Oof, so we had a nice battle last time. And our first battle ever, after like 16 hours into the game. So funny. Before we get started, I just want to say I've hardly been getting any likes on these videos. I've been getting views, and I've been getting some comments, but a lot of times the people I'll get like multiple comments on a video and no likes. Yeah, I don't want to bother you guys about it, but it really does help the channel if you throw a like on a video, and it gives me incentive to keep going, as it were. I keep trying to click here and, you know, go to that place, and, you know, if you played Pillars, you know what I mean. Pillars of Eternity. But yeah, I don't know if people pilfered Numenera purchased here. I don't know if people are just, you know, they don't really like the videos, don't think they deserve a like, or you guys have just been forgetting. I don't know. But yeah, I just wanted to throw that in. And starting with this episode, we are now in version 1.0.2, as opposed to 1.01. Did I talk to this guy? Hawker. But anyway, I'm going to talk to him in a second. 1.0.2 is the major changes that I see. Fixes freezes. Performance optimizations, always good. Addendum text on item description. Now, with certain lore that you have, there's nothing here, you will get addendums on, you know, on things you have. And I'm just looking for... I'm guessing it's going to be a separate paragraph, you know, down beneath... Don't use it. I think Pillars, the closed box, was here. That's why I want to keep going there. I... see. I mean, I have lore machinery. Here. This is added for lore natural. Train. So I have lore natural and lore machinery, and I think I might have one other. But this shadow step? Yeah. Too bad you can't actually move that window around. I have chosen not at this time to put it into bonded items because... Max plus 6. It gives you negative 2 might. And I can only use, you know, 2 at a time, so. But anyway, not going to read that again. If you want to pause the video and look at this part. There are many rumors whispered about Shadow Step, especially in the shadows of alleyways and dark corners of taverns, for they allow those with ill intent to quickly catch up with the target or make a fast getaway. One story tells of a glaive who tried to skip town after he stole from his fellow travelers, only to find the party's jack ahead of him wherever he went, until in desperation he leapt from a cliff. The jack returned the stolen loot but kept his part for herself. Little things like that. See, I remember stuff like that from Pillars of Eternity. The stories behind items. Pretty interesting. So quest items, yeah, I looked at these, okay. We have looked at everything on me. Just take a quick look. A buzzer. The quest item is going to be the same. Okay. Yeah, I didn't think anything. Regular shield, regular broadsword. Little tier stuff. here. So I guess it's just on special items like that. Okay, so anyway, fixes, freezes, performance optimizations, addendum text on item description.
We have better taste than that.
Oh, I'm tasting.
It's not the flavor. It's the aftertaste.
What? Sorry, I just realized they were talking amongst each other. More party banter, like you've just seen. I was just about to say. Crises are rebalanced. Some will be quicker, like ones that take a long time. I've only been in one, so I can't really judge. And fixes to pathing and AI. Meaning, for the last 5 or 6 episodes, we've been stuck with this guy. What's his name? Eritus. Not coming with us. So now he's coming with us. Very good to see. And I thought Tybier was going to be stuck at the end because then he wouldn't move. Ugh. Is this guy selling anything worth anything? You wonder why no one's reported me. Maybe they've tried. Maybe they can't. So I can't buy anything from you. Can't buy anything from this one. You're squinting. Don't do that. They'll give you wrinkles. You sound like my mother. If it ain't Stitcher taking you home, it's walking mold, rogue constructs, or some other damn thing. Alright, let's go to the Underbelly. Finally, the last district of the city.
Fine.
At least that I know of. I'm really just having a blast exploring all this. There's like so much to see. And I'm sure at some point we're going to go past the city. I mean, if this is just a city, how much more is there to see? So we got a pauper. Eritus. Why is... Excuse me. Throat noise. Why is his... Good idea.
What? We ready to go?
Ooh. He has a cranial fracture from his... the last battle. Or the one battle. -1 intellect edge. Well, it's a lot less extreme, a lot less alarming than a real life cranial fracture. I'll give it that. And when we rest, it just miraculously goes away.
As you wish.
I wish I lived in this world. Headless man. Okay. Meatmonger saying meat, meat, meat. And there's the pauper we saw. Cheap and tasty meat, straight from the vat. Little pauper, where's the prince? Meuk's no meatmonger. He's an artist. Alright. Did he take the meat from your skull? Sro. This vat is filled with wriggling reptilian tails, knotted and tangled together. Reptilian tails. Hail, meatmonger. A short, solid man stands behind a smoking grill, turning pieces of meat with a pair of grimy tongs. Sweat is pouring down his grizzled face, yet he's covered head to toe in grease-spattered clothes. His sleeves are tight at the wrists, and his collar pinches his neck. Nearby are 3 large vats that are filled with living meat, great amorphous masses of it, with appendages growing from them like the limbs of animals drowning in a meat swamp. The first vat is filled with thick, throbbing muscles, red and raw. Oh my god. The second is a flapping monstrosity of leathery wings, and the third sprouts hundreds of lac tails, all wiggling obscenely. And you eat a bunch of mussels, you know? And not the sea creatures. The cook looks up from his work and gives you a sweaty smile. Hey ho! I'm Meuk, the meatmonger. What do you have? Why are you all bundled up like that? On account of the toes. Nobody wants to see a man with toes growing all over his body, especially if he's cooking their food. Not even people in the underbelly get strong enough stomachs for that. What? Did you say you have toes growing all over your body? Hey, we all got our problems, and I got it better than most around here. Ain't my fault anyway. Well, I guess it's a little bit my fault. I got toes growing out of me in places toes don't usually grow. Nobody wants to see that. I'm looking for a jack named Metkina. Pale skin, hard looks, wears a hood. He nods. Know her well. Buys for me all the time. Haven't seen her in a while, though. You might ask Mapper, over there by the shanties. He'll be the one with the maps on his skin. Keeps track of everybody. Maps on his skin. So he's got toes on him, and the other guy's got maps on him. What kind of meat do you sell? He laughs and bangs the grill with his tongs, making sizzling grease fly. Three kinds, friend. Anine, Drebel, and Lack. Right in those vats, actually. Want some? I'd like to see the secondary text. He whirls his tongs around a finger with a flourish and points toward the nearby vats of pulsing flesh. I've never seen meat grown in a vat before. How does it work? How? He shrugs. Couldn't tell you. Found a little doodad back when I was a butcher, and I'd fiddle with it all day long. Kinda like I do now with my tongs. He waves the tongs around to show you what he means. So one day, I was fiddling with this thing while cutting up a carcass, and it kept growing back its missing parts. Cut the tail off, and there it was again, a moment later. Crazy, right? But it gave me an idea. I could open a little grill with no overhead, and it worked. Been cooking the same three hunks of flesh for years now. He beams. Regenerating meat for sale, wow. Little doodad I got makes meat grow. No idea why, but it lets me run this stand for years on the same three hunks of meat. It's great. Can you use your doodad on yourself? Let me guess. He did it on his toe or something. Funny you should ask. Not long after I found it, I cut myself pretty good. Thought I'd try using my doodad to close up the wound. He grimaces. Well, it worked, but then I started growing toes all over my body. Didn't care for that at all, so I never did it again. Still trying to get rid of the toes. Still trying to get rid of the toes, yeah, you know. Just think, guys, when you have problems, just think, at least you don't have toes growing all over you. At least there's that. I'd like to buy some meat. Sure. What would you like? Anine shank? Drebel wing? Lack tail? Right. This is like the guy in Planescape Torment that sells the rat tails. And I don't know, it's a small amount per tail. But hopefully it's the same here, because I don't see prices. I can't ask him about prices. I'll try a lack tail. I have 271 gold. That'll be two shins. Alright. Are they all two shins? Two shins. Buy a treble wing. Good choice. Meuk produces a jagged knife and saws one of the leathery wings from the fluttering mass and tosses it onto his grill. It flaps weakly for a few moments, then lies still. An aroma like sweet baking fruit begins to rise from a stiffening wing. After a short time, Meuk lifts it from the grill with a pair of tongs and hands it to you. You take a bite. The wing is crunchy and sweet, with a rich and fruity taste. Good, eh? Nobody believes it till they try. Mute grins and slaps his belly. I eat them all day long. Keeps me trim and handsome. I'll buy one of each. There are only two, you know, right? I'll buy the lacktail. Oh. He doesn't think this is a good idea. He shrugs, giving you a dubious look. With a quick motion of his hand, Meuk tears two wriggling lacktails from the vat, twists them together, and ties them into a loop. Then he drops them on the grill, where they begin to sizzle and spit. As they cook, the green and white color grows brighter and more intense. After a short while, Meuk takes them from the grill and hands them to you. Somehow the tails are still wriggling as you take a tentative bite. The meat is flaky, overly sweet, and it fizzes in your mouth like bubbly water. Meuk shakes his head. Kids love those things. Can't stand them myself. Let's try the last. I'm gonna eat a freaking mussel. Meuk nods, saunters over to the vat of red, throbbing mussels, and carves off a slice. He spears the meat with a sharpened bone skewer and slaps it onto his grill, sprinkling it with a flurry of spices. When the meat is cooked, he hands you the skewer and you take a bite. The meat is gamey and a little tough, but the spices are so intense that you hardly notice. Lots of folks eat that 3 times a day, Meuk winks. Wish more of them would give my treble wings a try. What's their loss, eh? Yeah, experience. You take another bite of the anine meat, trying to get a sense of the flavor that lies beneath the heavy spice. Its taste summons a welter of memories. You've eaten anine flesh before, perhaps many times. It evokes a vague sense of desperation, of a vast ruined landscape. Detonations erupting around you, scavenging the bodies of fallen beasts for food. You realize that it isn't one memory, but many, many lifetimes. Many lifetimes, perhaps, in a hellscape of war. The memories fade. Huh. Now, is that just from the anine meat? Well, because we tried all three of them. That we got this experience. Right, friend. Come again. Alright, well, let's continue up this way, then. I was a kid.
Child.
Did you see all the blood over there? Someone must have killed 100 people.
Where?
Well, there's a mapper. Maybe talk to these paranoid people. Probably gonna freak out. You know, it's busy sharing their paranoia together. You know too, don't you? You smell the corruption. Yes, the jagged dream is down here too. I see things, you know. I have special eyes. Okay, then. Love the music so much.
Hello, Calesthesians!
Don't shout. When you do, we can all hear you. It makes you even more irritating than normal.
I understand calesthesias!
Is that how you say... That's not how you say her name. He's adding an S on the end. Is her name Calesthesia? I've been saying Calesthesia. I don't really trust him to be able to say it right, but... So let's talk to... Popper and Mapper. Alright. It's the map! I'm the map! From a distance, it looks as if this mutant is wearing a form-fitting suit of finely patterned lines in white, yellow, and pale blue. I like that effect there. On closer examination, it becomes apparent that these are tattoos, and they cover nearly the entirety of his body, even his shaved head. His actual clothes are simple and worn, and his boots look as though they've seen hard use. He is studying the meaningless swirls and whorls on his arms, and mouthing names that mean nothing to you. Solvi, Balint, Urgao. 10 trees. When he looks up at you, you see that a strange device covers one of his eyes. A deep blue light shines in its center, and it seems to measure and evaluate you as he focuses on you. He smiles as you approach, a broad, beaming grin that says he considers you a friend already. I'm Mapper, he says, extending his hand. And he's thinking, a new face. New faces mean new places. I've been everywhere around here. I've found my way into places long sealed and best forgotten. Met all sorts of people. He frowns. Can't say I cared much for some of them, it's true. His voice is fast, insistent, and incisive. Oh well, I'm not voicing him like that, am I? Still, I try. The communities of our world are islands of light. Sometimes they wink out, and sometimes they flare up. I want to link them together. I want to be a bridge. You say you want to be a bridge? How do you even do that? He shrugs, a faint smile on his lips. I travel. I see places. I map them out on my skin, and maybe inside me. I don't know. I mean, the lines change when I look, and they've got to be stored someplace, right? He scratches his bald head. The lines flow under his fingers. I just need to collect places. I need to know that I've done something. Making maps is all I know. It's all I want to know. He beams. I travel. I go all over. I add to my maps. I learn places inside and out, and they become a part of me. Why else does anyone travel but to take a piece of their destination with them? Me, I just get more. I'm looking for a woman named Matkina. Do you know where I can find her?
I'll remember that.
Updated my journal. Matkina? The White Death? I've heard of her. I know where she hides, too. He grins wide, exposing a mouth full of extraordinarily white and clean teeth. I can tell you where she is, but I hate to say it comes with a price. Much as I love to talk about my travels, I need to finish a patch of my Sagus Cliffs map, and I need bragging rights for the next time I see the navigators. He shrugs. Also, she might not be happy, I've told. But I might be able to help you if you find it. For a trade, of course. He drops his voice. Have you ever heard of the Changing God? Savior of Sagus Cliffs in times past and so forth? They say he had a sanctuary under the city, a place he used to retreat to and plan for the future while he thought on his past. You know, making possibility maps. That sanctuary is the one important place I haven't seen in Sagus Cliffs, and he needed to fill in my map. A sanctuary under the city. Well, we're in Underbelly, so I guess it's under Underbelly. As far as I can tell, it's not far past the Stitcher Lair. Oh, we're gonna see a Stitcher Lair? The problem I'm having is that I just can't make any sense of their language. Maybe you can talk to them. He shrugs disarmingly. It's a hell of a price, I know, but there it is. If you want to find Matkina, you'll find the sanctuary for me. Why don't you go look for the sanctuary yourself? Disgust-sucking Stitcher, that's why. They've got their precious eggs in their lair, and they won't let me in. It's not like I've got any interest in the eggs, but... I got no patience for dealing with their clicks and rumbles. I just want to know, got me? Is there some other way into the sanctuary besides the Stitcher lair? There must be. Changing God wasn't the kind of person who'd put just one entrance into the place, but I haven't been able to find the back door for the life of me. I want to ask you some other questions. He's already started to return to his examination of his tattoos, and he responds absently, "Go ahead." Where did you get all those tattoos? These are not tattoos. They're maps. He exposes a shiny grin. Maps of places I've been or heard of. He covers the artificial eye with his hand and says, If I look at my skin like this, it's meaningless. Then he uncovers it and says, "But look at it like this. Suddenly, I see the map. Springing up off my skin, I focus on it. It all becomes clear. Buildings, people, smells, even a route to get there. It's worthless to anyone else, of course, without me to interpret the map. It's a combination of my mutation and the lens. Finding the eyepiece was the best part of being born like this. It made me feel like my life made sense, at least. And that, my friend, is far more luck than anyone deserves." His easy grin pops up. "My life's work. I mean, literally, eh? I go someplace, or I hear about someplace, and the lines start to curl and twist on my skin. I look at them through this." He taps the lens over his right eye, "and they come clear. They make sense. I know the world here. Any place I've been, I can look at my body, and I'm there again." "Where have you been?" "Huh. It's probably easier to ask where I haven't been. All over the Sagus Protectorate, the oasis of Emrah Julios, Valley of Dead Heroes, Corn Village, the ruins of Acropolesia, and all around me, all around the Black Cube. Towers of Birds where Thurdlas fell, even up past the Clock of Kala, Dvralk." As he speaks, the lines of his body shift and move, coming into prominence with the words. "Every place was a treat, an experience. Did you know most people never go more than 50 kilometers from the village of their birth, if that? I've been tremendously lucky, my friend." He smiles down at his maps. Then he looks back at you and says more quietly, "If you plan to travel, I'd avoid the Glasslands, though. The birds will take your meat for their meals, and your bones for their nests." He looks down at his stomach, and his smiling gaze falls upon the lines. And as his smiling gaze falls upon the lines, they start to flow and writhe. "Too many to count. Memories stack and overflow, but the maps paint the territory, make each place distinct. Join the world together, like Vralk here, a place of blasted serpents, vicious plants, and evil people. Still, it has its own twisted beauty. Or take the oasis, the water bubble in the middle of the lost sea." His eyes lose their focus. "I can see them even now. Can you tell me where I should start looking to find the Changing God's sanctuary?" He blows out from his cheeks. "That's a good question, friend. A good question. If I knew, I wouldn't be asking you, eh? All I know is that it's in a void beneath the city." He chews his tongue for a moment, thinking. "You know how cities build and build on themselves? It's like that. What I mean is that Sagus got built on top of an old Sagus, and that got built on a Sagus before that, before it was even Sagus, right? So this old sanctuary, it's in one of the places between the eras, but I haven't been able to find a way to get there, and friend, believe me when I say, that's the kind of thing that cocks me fierce." He frowns. "Find the void, and you should be able to find his place. Farewell. Travel well, my friend." Is this the same kid? What's the Jagged Dream? Those two weird people keep talking about it. No weirder than this guy with no head. Okay. Oh, we got thugs. We got Fulsome. Oh, I've heard about this Fulsome, haven't I? Varenoth? This grisly crime scene is blocked by Fulsome and his thugs. Alright, let's talk to Varenoth first, and we'll probably call it an episode then. What the hell is this? Are those eyes? They're things. They look like eyes coming in and out of that. That's so weird. Anyway, let's talk to Varenoth.
"Which one of you Calisthesians is the one that likes me?"
None of us do, Eritus.
That's why he's calling her Calestesias. There's more than one of her. Okay, so I'm gonna start calling her Calestige. I think Calestige sounds normal. I mean, like, better. This large and heavily muscled woman wears what appear to be rags that should have fallen apart ages ago. She looks so tired that it wouldn't be a surprise if she fell asleep on her feet. And yet, when she opens her mouth, her voice is energetic, like a little girl who's about to get a present. Hello! Can anyone hear what I'm saying? Ah, I can't make this work. Without warning, she slaps herself. I hope no one saw that. Oddly, no thoughts at all come from this woman. At least you think she has none. There's a faint whispering at the edge of your hearing, but you can't make out any words. Who are you? Are you talking to me? Her head swivels awkwardly around, trying to catch a glimpse of you. Oh, you are. My name is Varenoth, champion of the wastes. The woman flinches at the sound of the very different booming voice that came from her own mouth. That's not my name, you stupid thing. It's Varenoth, champion of the waste. Damn. I come from a land you've never heard of. Damn it. I guess I'm not allowed to say. It's another one of these people who've lost their identity. They have another being inside them. Just like, loss of self. The woman flinches at the sound of... Oh, shit, I've read that already. So you aren't Varenoth, champion of the wastes? These are all fair questions. I'm not, but you might as well just call me that, or just Varenoth. One shoulder shrugs and keeps shrugging. Oh, these people. I'm not actually here. I'm just talking through her and trying to move her around. Her shoulder freezes mid-shrug. These poor people have problems that no one should have to deal with. It keeps yelling over me if I talk about something I'm not supposed to, she says, lowering her voice. But maybe if I speak carefully. Her chin drops to her chest. My family explores the world, using special tools. The body stabs itself with its finger pointedly. But they tell me I'm too young to help. So I waited until everyone was sleeping and... you know. The head lolls back on its neck, winking at the roof of the cavern. Are you an explorer too? I saw no reason to lie to her. I am, but not like you. Oh! Oh! For some reason, I thought that you were a champion of the waste, too. Damn, I did it again, didn't I? Just don't tell anyone what I am, alright? Why do your people explore? Our impenetrable fortress in a lost valley is falling apart. I think we should just go out into the world for real. But no, my family is afraid. The fingers on the woman's right hand wiggle like they were playing an instrument. Her dead expression doesn't change even as the girl's voice rises. I'm not, of course, but they won't even let me use this thing. I have to sneak around, like a child. Because we're looking for a new home, but Aragoth, Lord of the North, thinks we'll die if we go without... Oh, it did it again, didn't it? Who are you again? Varenoth, champion of the waste, the older woman bellows. Sorry, I tried to say my real name again. What can that construct do? Well, it's really hard to break. My mother, that's who usually controls it, once got stepped on by an adult earthshaker. It just stuck her in the ground like a nail. The woman flexes a massive bicep. Am I flexing? I'm trying to flex. Anyway, it's also incredibly strong. Punch holes in mountains strong. The arm flops back to her hip. And it's not really a construct. There's no metal inside. She has blood, bones, perfect human expressions. Not that you can tell that from how I do it. The girl adds sourly. Sourly, the woman's face grimaces along with her. Where did you get the construct? I was born in a storm on a battlefield at night, the woman roars. Huh, the girl says after a respectful silence. She really doesn't want me to tell you what I just tried to tell you. Can't you tell me anything about where you got this construct? Seeds, the girl blurts. Oh, she let me say it, but I probably won't get away with more. Sorry. Huh. Farewell. Oh, farewell. Wow, okay. I got here water. A flight of stone steps descends into the water. The cavern beyond gradually widens and connects to the sea. Same here. Wait. The portraits are in the way. Same here. Someone's fishing. That's an interact, yeah. Okay, well, we'll interact with that and deal with these guys next time. Thanks so much for watching, guys, and see you next time. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.
Stop fidgeting. Be still and silent. All three.
I don't understand how all you Calisthenes could even notice in that crowd of you.
A few thousand of my eyes can't help but notice you.